Right here we have a Ford Focus RS. So this started life as a completely standard road-going Ford Focus RS, as you'll see many on the road today. It's been through several stages. It took about 12 months to build and complete to the stage where it is now. So in its spec that you see it here today, it's a fully fledged endurance race car. This is capable of going to Dubai, doing 24-hour races in all sorts of climates. There's not a lot that this car isn't capable of doing in the motorsport endurance world. With endurance racing in mind, one of the key features of this car is the fact that it's not fitted with standard fuses. Gone are the days when if a fuse blows, you'd have to remove the blade fuse, put the new one in to get that electrical system going again. We've upgraded this car to breaker switches, which means rather than a fuse blowing, the worst we'll get is one of these pop out, which means it's overloaded, there's been too much current, so this has popped out. The reason we use these is, rather than him having to come in and risk a pit stop, the driver can simply stretch his arm down, push in the dial, and he resets that electrical system, doing away with the old-fashioned type of a fuse blowing, causing him to lose time during a race. As you go around the car, you'll notice a lot of other things, again, designed around endurance racing. If this was to be out in an extremely warm climate, we've got air ducts here to get air to the driver and help cool him down. Around the back, this is an absolutely essential part of an endurance race car. This is the quick fuel system. During endurance race, we need to get fuel into the car so it can carry on running, but we need to get fuel into the car as quickly as possible. So this system is designed to get fuel in this hole as fast as possible and the air comes out this one. So using a dump churn, when this is filled up with fuel, the pit crew operating this will be in full fire retardant gear simply because we've got highly flammable fuel and we've got exhaust tailpipes, which will be very hot. So during a race, the boot will come up, this will be full of fuel, and by driving that into the designated holes, you'll release the fuel. And in about 3 or 4 seconds, you'll lose a whole 20 litres of fuel straight into the tank, which means you can release it, shut the boot, and the car will be back out on track in a matter of seconds. Similar to the quick release fuel system, if we need to do a tyre change, the old fashioned way of using a trolley jack such as this just isn't quick enough. If I was to turn this and try and jack it up, it's going to take me an age to get the car off the ground. So what we use is a system called air jacks, which means when opening this hatch, I put this lance into the nozzle and I fill a system, a pneumatic system, with compressed air. That in turn fires out 3 individual pistons which hit the ground and they lift the car in the air in a matter of seconds, meaning we can change wheels and tyres a lot faster in a pit stop. So that gets pushed in there, the car bounces up in the air, it stays in the air, change the tyres or do whatever we need to do. Then on releasing it, pull that nozzle, the whole car will sit back on the ground and the driver can take off a lot quicker than using the old fashioned trolley jack method. The cockpit itself, you'll see, it's absolutely stacked to the brim with different gadgets. Everything on this dash pod here is designed for the driver, either to aid the driver, tell him information, or the controls the driver needs to use. So you'll see on this side here, we have the emergency fire button. In the event of emergency, by pushing that red button there, you will release the fire extinguisher. Here we have the brake control. So this dial here will change the brake bias from the front to the rear of the car. The screen is absolutely essential because this screen and this system of LEDs will tell the driver all the information he needs to know. Everything from his lap times to engine temperature, coolant temperature, and what gear he's in. If there's any problems, he'll get a flashing red light on here and he'll get a message come up on the bottom of the dash warning him what the problem is. He can then radio that to the pit crew and we can prepare ourselves for when he next comes into a pit stop. On the left-hand side, you'll see a system of toggle switches all labeled. The top row being lights, so when it's in its endurance spec and it's kitted out to do a night race, by switching these, it'll turn on all the different lights and spotlights the car has. Then it's the standard things which have been removed as a road car, things such as indicators, wipers, and other switches are for fans, power steering, fuel pumps, ignition, and of course the start button. You'll notice an extended mirror, so this convex mirror gives the driver a much greater 360 view of everything that's going on around him. So not only does he use his wing mirrors to see what's behind him, he can actually see each side of the car by looking through the rear view mirror. These are the air jacks I was talking about, so the car's situated with 3 air jacks. There's one here on the opposite side and one in the middle. So when the air jack lance is inserted into the side of the car, the air pushes out a cylinder here and the whole car jumps up in the air. You'll notice from looking around there's hardly anything that resembles a normal Ford Focus. All the pedal boxes have changed, the seat position's changed, there's virtually nothing you'll see in a road car. A really crucial design point about this car was getting the driver's weight further back. The reason we do this is to improve the centre of gravity. If the driver sits too far forward as he would in a conventional road car, it's hard for us to balance the car as well as intended to get the best possible grip on the tarmac. With that in mind, we extend the driver's seat as far back as we can, which is why you'll see it looks like he's virtually sitting in the back of the car. In doing that, you also need to extend the steering column and all the pedals, because it's one thing being able to sit further back, but he still needs to be able to control the car comfortably. So the steering is extended, the pedals are extended, and of course a custom-made dashboard has to be inserted to cover up all the machinery and ECUs. At the end of the night race in 2013, it became apparent that there was one element of this car that was slowing down the driver. This was the gearbox, because at the time it was still running the standard Ford gearbox, which is a H pattern gearbox. Now the disadvantage of this being that every gear change a driver makes, you lose roughly about 1.5 seconds. Now bear in mind the amount of times you change gear on a lap, this was having a detrimental effect on our lap time. So between ourselves and Perry, the owner, we decided to upgrade the gearbox to what is known as a sequential gearbox, which means there isn't the use of a clutch, and you change gear by simply using paddles on the steering wheel or a lever inside the cockpit. And this dramatically reduces the time it takes to change gear, in result ending up in a faster lap time. We took this decision because we didn't really have much of a choice. When you look at the class we were racing in, all of our competition had sequential gearboxes. So the fact that we had completely redesigned and rebuilt this car and left the standard gearbox in was almost the only thing holding it back. So we decided it was the time and the place to take some time out and put a sequential gearbox in. So one of the things you need to remember, these cars are not designed for comfort. Once the driver's in, he's strapped in with a full harness, which comes down over his shoulders as well as his waist, meaning that he essentially becomes part of the seat. It's very, very difficult for the driver to move once he's strapped in. This, of course, is with safety as paramount. So in the event of emergency, by pulling the lug, all the straps come off and the driver can get out. Here you'll see the system which was upgraded throughout 2014. The paddles to the left and to the right of the steering wheel are the sequential gearbox paddles, meaning that now for the driver to change gear, he simply uses his left hand to go down and his right hand to go up a gear. The only time he needs to use the clutch is when he pulls away in first gear. Apart from that, it's up and down through the gears as and when he likes. On the steering wheel itself, these are the essential buttons that are used much more frequently than the switches on the left. For example, you have a push to talk button. By pushing that button, the driver activates the microphone inside his helmet, talking to the pit crew. These two buttons here scroll through the dash, meaning he can go through different pages and check different sources of information. Here, we have everything needed to control the windscreen wipers and flash the headlights. So he can flash slower cars out the way, and he can wipe the windscreen in case of any debris or fluids. On the right hand side is a pit limit button. The driver will press this button when he's in the pit lane, as there's a very strict speed limit on the pit lane. So by pressing this, the car will automatically control itself to not go over the pit speed limit, meaning he can keep full throttle depressed and he knows he won't break the speed limit, incurring any pit penalties. The reason we had to take time out of the season is because no one had ever put a sequential gearbox on this type of engine before, meaning we couldn't just go to companies and buy parts straight off the shelf. We effectively had to start from scratch, and with the help of a company called TDI Developments, who we work closely with, this gearbox was designed, developed and installed. All in all, it took about 8 months to complete, so effectively the car lost an entire season. It hasn't competed in 2014. Reason being is it was brought off the track to make these essential upgrades. Now we find ourselves in a situation where the gearbox has been completed, it's been fitted, and in a day's time we're going out for the very first time on track with this gearbox, which is hugely exciting because if all goes according to plan, this car should be faster, easier to drive, and in general a much, much more appealing car to a driver, and it will give us a better chance of winning. The engine bay itself had to be also upgraded, including this gold tape. This was designed to reflect heat away from the bulkhead. Bearing in mind this car can compete in endurance races in very hot climates, the idea of this was to stop heat soaking from the engine onto the bulkhead, heating up the cockpit, making it a very unbearable condition for the driver. So the gold tape helps protect the driver overheating. Also inside the engine bay, you'll see the nozzle here for the fire extinguisher, if the 5-stinger was to be released, this is where the foam would come out and soak the entire engine and all the fuel system in a fire extinguishing foam. These two canisters here are used to control the suspension. This car is fitted with an entirely adjustable suspension kit, meaning that we can change the rebound, high speed and low speed to suit the driver's demands. Some of the key features you'll notice in here, we've spec'd everything with endurance racing in mind. So for example, if the battery runs low, bear in mind it's got a lot of electrical systems that take a lot of current. We can grab this here, which is an auxiliary battery unit, and by plugging that into this clamp here, immediately we give the car a surge of power. So if we're in a hot spot, we can't get power, we can't get the engine started, by putting this in immediately, we give ourselves a much better chance of getting the electrics going again. Also in here you'll notice all the key safety equipment. So here we have the fire extinguisher, which houses a type of foam. In the event of emergency, by pressing one single button, that fire extinguisher will erupt through a series of nozzles located all around the inside cockpit and the engine bay, soaking both the engine and driver in foam to protect them. Here you'll see the radio communication equipment. So this is designed so the driver can communicate with the pit crew at all times simply by pressing a button on the steering wheel. All the other boxes you'll see are individual ECUs for different components of the car. For example, over here we have an ECU which controls the inboard cameras. We have one for the compressor which does the gear sticks. And we have a data logger down here to log all the data for the championship requirements so they can keep an eye on who's cheating and who's not cheating.